Hello students, welcome to Memoni. I hope everyone is doing fine. And till now, I think you both, you all have solved the chemistry section of Brahmastra Partest 4. So let's begin with the solution of BPT 4 of chemistry section. Okay, let's start with section A. In question number 51, what does question number 51 says? Match list 1 with list 2. Okay. So here is the list 1 and here is the list 2. List 1 we have the quantum numbers and list 2 we have the information provided. So what we have to do, we have to match the quantum numbers with the information provided. Okay, let's see. So first one is ML. Okay, it is not MI, it is ML. So ML, MS, L and N. So we have to match all this. Okay, and find the correct answer from the options given below. So let us see the explanation of this answer. Yeah, so see. Principal quantum number describes the energy and size of the orbital. Principal quantum number is N. Okay. N is the principal quantum number and it is denoted by N. So what does N represents? It represents the size of the orbital. Okay. It represents the size of the orbital. So D option will have 4. So D matches with 2. Okay. The next azimuthal quantum number describes the shape of the given orbital. Okay. So azimuthal quantum number describes the shape of the given orbital and it is represented by L. So L represents the azimuthal quantum number. Okay. Azimuthal quantum number and it describes the shape of the orbital. Okay, so it describes the shape of the orbital. So option number D correct answer, option number C correct answer will be option 1. Next is magnetic quantum number. It is represented by MS. Okay, MS is for magnetic quantum number. So magnetic quantum number is, it describes the orientation of these orbitals. Okay, it describes the orientation of orbitals. So B will have option 3 as the correct option. And next is spin quantum number and it is described by, okay sorry, magnetic quantum number is ML. Yeah, magnetic quantum number is ML and it describes the orientation of the orbital. Okay, so A will have option 3. Then what is left? MS. MS is the spin quantum number. Spin quantum number describes the spinning of the orbital. Okay, it describes the orientation and spin of the orbital. So B will have option 4 as the correct option. Okay. Yeah. So B will have option 4 as the correct option. So which one is the correct option here? A will have option 3. So option 2 and option 3 will be cut. Then A will have option 3. C will have option 1. Okay. So option 4 is the correct option. B will have option 4 and D will have option 2. So option number 4 is the correct option to this question. Okay. Next question is question number 52. In question number 52, it is asked that which one is the wrong statement. Okay, so we have to find out the wrong statement. The electronic configuration of the nitrogen atom is. So, the electronic configuration of the nitrogen atom. So, this is the electronic configuration. Let's read the other option first. Option 2 says the number is designated by 3 quantum numbers while the electron in an atom is designated by 4 quantum numbers. Okay, so this is 2. The total orbital quantum momentum, sorry, the total orbital angular momentum of an electron is s orbital is equal to 0. Okay, so this is also 2. S orbital, the total orbital angular momentum is 0. And the value for m for dz square is 0. This is also 2. So this option 1 is the wrong statement. So let's see how it is the wrong statement. It is a wrong statement because it does not follow the Hund's rule. Hund's rule of maximum multiplicity. So according to Hund's rule, the electrons are to be filled like this way. First this electron, then this electron in 1s orbital, 1s2 orbital, then in 2s first this electron and then this electron. And in 2p orbital, na 2p orbital first the upper spin electrons are filled. Okay, like this, 3 electrons are filled, or like this electrons are filled. This arrangement is not possible according to Hund's rule. Like 2 are upside and 1 is down. So this this type of arrangement is not possible. So this is the wrong statement. Okay, this electron configuration is not possible according to Hund's rule. Option number 1 is the correct option. Question number 53. In question number 53, it is an assertion reason type question. So assertion says that energy of an orbital increases with increase of principal quantum number, and its reason is energy is required in shifting away the negatively charged electron from positively charged nucleus. So let's see. Principal quantum number describes the energy and size of the orbital. Okay, it is denoted by n. We know that principal quantum number, it is denoted by n, and it represents the energy and size of the orbital, as we have seen in question number 1 only, question number 51. Okay, with the help of principal quantum numbers, the average distance of the electrons can be determined. Okay, so it can determine the average distance of the electron, distance of the electron from the nucleus, the energy and size of the orbital increases as the value of principal quantum number increases. Okay, so principal quantum number basically describes the size of the orbital. Okay, n can be 1, 2 or 3, 4, it depends on the number of shells. So this is the nucleus or say neutron. So these are the number of shells. As the number of shells increases, the distance also increases and the size of the atom also increases. Okay, so it depends on the principal quantum number only. So as the number of shells increases or n value increases, the number or the size of the orbital also increases, right? The lower the value of n plus 1 for an orbital, the lower is the energy. Now see, first one is correct. Okay, first one is correct. Then if two orbitals have the same value of n plus 1, the orbital with the lower value of n will have the lower energy. As n value increases, the energy of orbital increases. Okay, the lower the value, if orbitals have same value, see, energy is required in shifting away the negatively charged nucleus from the positively charged nucleus. Okay, this is also true. And if two orbitals have the same value of n plus 1, their orbital with lower value of n will have the lower energy. As n value increases, orbital increases. So option number 2, that means both assertion and reason are true, but reason is not a correct explanation. Okay, reason is something else, it is true, but it is not the correct explanation for the assertion. Okay, option number 2 will be the correct option. Next is question number 54. It is given match the columns. So we have to match the columns. Column 1 is for quantum number and column 2 is the information provided. Okay, column 1. So principal quantum number, azimuthal, magnetic spin. So this is the same question as question number 51, only the symbol is not given. Principal quantum number is n, azimuthal quantum number is l, magnetic quantum number is ml, and spin quantum number is ms. Okay, so we have just done this question for principal quantum number. It describes the shape of the orbital. So A will have option S. A will have option S. So option 2, wait. Yeah, sorry. It will describe the size of the quantum number, right? So principal quantum number describes the energy and size of the orbital. So A will have option Q. A will have option Q, so option 2 will be cut. Okay. Now azimuthal quantum number. Azimuthal quantum number, it describes the shape of the orbital. So azimuthal, B will have option S as the correct option. So B will have option S, which means this one will be cut. Next is magnetic quantum number. So magnetic quantum number gives the total number of orbitals in the subshell and describes the orientation of these orbitals. Okay, so it will describe the orientation. C will have option P as the correct answer. So option number 1 will be the correct answer for this question. Okay, Similarly, spin quantum number, it will describe the spin of the electron. Next question is question number 55. So in question number 55, we have to find out the orientation of an atomic orbital. So orientation of an atomic orbital, it is given by, orientation is given by which quantum number? It is given by magnetic quantum number, right? Magnetic quantum number describes the magnetic quantum number, gives the total number of orbitals and the orientation of these orbitals. Okay, so magnetic quantum number is the answer. Next is question 56. Identify the incorrect statement from the following. All the 5d orbitals are different in size when compared to the respective 4d orbitals, or the 5 4d orbitals have similar shapes respective to 3d orbitals. In an atom, all the 5 3d orbitals are equal in energy in a free state. The shapes of dxy, dyz and dxz orbitals are similar to each other, and dx square, y square and dz are similar to each other. Question number 56. In question number 56, let us see which is the incorrect option. The shape of 4d orbitals differ from those of 3d orbitals. Okay. Shape of 4d orbitals differ from those of 3d orbitals while they have while they share similar orbital types, their size and spatial distributions vary due to the different principal quantum number. Okay, so there are total of 5d quantum numbers named as, so we know that there are total of 5d quantum numbers, dxy, dyz, dzx, dx square, y square and dz square. Okay, out of these 5d orbitals, the first 4 are similar in shape. Okay, so let us first draw the d orbitals, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, 5, these are the d orbitals. Let us name this, this is dxy, dyz, dzx, dx square, y square and this is dz square. Okay, so out of these, now out of these 5, the first 4 are similar in shape. So these first 4, let us draw with a different color. So what happens, these first 4 are similar in shape. Okay, these are similar in shape, their shape is in the form of double dumbbell. See, These four are similar in shape. These are double dumbbell shape. Okay. But dz square is different from other. See, dz square, it is like one dumbbell is there and this type of one s orbital type thing is there. Okay, one spherical shape thing is there. So this is dz square. It is not similar to other four. So option four, or statement 4, is the incorrect. Okay, because in the option 4 it is written that all are similar to each other. Okay, first 3 are similar and the second, 4th and 5th are similar, but this is not the correct option. So option number 4 is the correct option for this question. In question number 57, let us see in question number 57, when an electromagnetic radiation of wavelength 300 nanometer falls on the surface of a sodium, electrons are emitted with a kinetic energy of this much. What is the minimum energy needed to remove an electron from sodium? Okay, so let us try to do this question. Okay, so in question number 57, when an electromagnetic radiation, which means lambda, is given to us, which is 300 nanometer, falls on the surface of sodium, electrons are emitted with a kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is given to us, which is 1.68 into 10 to the power. 10 to the power, what is given? It is 5, yeah, I think 5 or 8. Sorry, it is 5. So, yeah, 1.68 into 10 to the power 5 joule per mole. Okay, so lambda is given to us and kinetic energy is given to us. What is being asked? What is the minimum energy needed to remove an electron? Okay, what is the minimum energy to remove an electron? So let us solve this question. So we have to find H mu naught. So we have to find H mu naught. The energy of E of a 300 nanometer photon is given by. So energy is given by h mu naught equals to h mu minus kinetic energy. Or we can say that it is like this, okay? Kinetic energy is equals to h mu minus h mu naught. We have to find this value, na, h mu naught. So therefore it is interchange. So this is the main formula. Okay, so h mu naught equals to h mu minus k. What is h mu? H mu is equals to hc by lambda. Okay. H is the constant, okay, which whose value is 6.626 into 10 to the power minus 34. C is the speed of light, 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. And lambda value is given to us, which is 300 nanometer. We have to convert it into meter. So 300 into 10 to the power minus 9 meter, okay. So its value comes out to be 6.626 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. So h mu value is this much. The energy of 1 mole of photon. What is the energy of 1 mole of photon? Then we have to find out h mu value we have been given, and kinetic energy value is given to us, which is 1.68. So let us see the energy of 1 mole of photon. For 1 mole we have to multiply it with Avogadro's constant. Therefore this is the energy of 1 mole of photon. The minimum energy needed to remove a mole of electron. Okay, it is equal to the energy of photon minus the kinetic energy of photon. Okay, so this is the only formula. Minimum energy required to remove. Required to remove a mole of electron from an electron is equals to energy of photon minus kinetic energy of electron, which means the minimum energy, how minimum energy we can calculate, it is equals to kinetic energy minimum energy required, h mu is equals to h mu minus kinetic energy, right? So h mu value we have calculated by hc by lambda minus kinetic energy is given to us. So like this we will calculate hc by lambda value. What we have get? 3.99 into 10 to the power minus 5, okay? So we will multiply it, or we can say we can minus it by kinetic energy. H mu by lambda, the value is 3.99 into 10 to the power 5 joule per mole, and kinetic energy is equals to 1.68 into 10 to the power minus 5 joule per mole. Okay, so its value 10 to the power 5 is common in both, so let us minus the values 1.68 into 10 to the power 5 joule per mole. Okay, so what it will come, it will be 2.31 into 10 to the power 5 joule per mole. This much value we are getting, right? So this value into 1 mole, which is equals to 3.84 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Okay, we have to calculate the minimum energy required. Now minimum energy required we have to find out in joule per mole. See, the option here are in joule per mole. So if you are writing it till here, now if you are writing it in till here joule per mole, then we have to convert it into 1 mole also. 1 mole also. So we will divide it by 6.023 into 10 to the power 23. So answer comes out to be 3.84 into 10 to the power minus 19. So option number 4 will be the correct question, right? Okay, so you must be thinking that why we are multiplying it with the Avogadro number. Okay, so it is necessary because we are finding the energy, minimum energy required to remove 1 mole of electron, right? So for 1 mole of electron, we have to divide it by Avogadro's number. So by this, we are getting the answer option 4 as the correct option. Okay. Next question is question number 58. So in question number 58, the work function of a metal is 4.2 electron volt. If a radiation of 2000 angstrom falls on the metal, then the kinetic energy of the fastest photoelectron is. Okay, so work function of a metal is, so work function we are donating, we are representing it by psi, so it is 4.2 electron volt. If a radiation of 2000 angstrom, okay, if a radiation of 2000 angstrom falls on the metal, then the kinetic energy of the fastest photoelectron is. So we have to find out the kinetic energy. Let's see the explanation. To determine the kinetic energy equals to h mu by psi. Psi is the work function. Okay. So K kinetic energy, Ke is the kinetic energy, H is the Planck's constant we know, V is the frequency of the incident radiation, and psi is the work function of the metal. Work function is given to us, which is 4.2. So E naught, what will be E naught? E naught will be 4.2, which is the value of psi, into 1.6 into 10 to the power 19. 1.6 is the H value, okay? It is the Planck's constant, H value. And by this we are getting 6.72 into 10 to the power minus 19. So energy absorbed by the electron. Energy absorbed by the electron, okay. Sorry, 1.6, it is not H value. 1.6 is so E naught equals to 4.2 into 1.6. Why we are dividing it by 6.023 to 10 to the power 23. So we have to find out the minimum energy now, which is required to remove one mole of electron. So in this case we have to multiply it by 6.023 into 10 to the power 23, which is the Avogadro number. So after then we can get the answer. Okay, so let us see in question number 58. The work function of a metal is 4.2 electron volt. So work function psi is equals to 4.2 electron volt. If radiation of 2000 angstrom falls on the metal, okay, radiation of 2000 angstrom falls on the metal, then the kinetic energy. So we have to find out the kinetic energy of the fastest photoelectron. Okay, so how we can find out? We have to determine the kinetic energy. To determine the kinetic energy, this is the formula, H mu by psi. Ke is the kinetic energy, H is the Planck's constant, V is the frequency of the incident radiation, and psi is the work function of the metal. Okay, work function of the metal, it is given as 4.2 electron volt. Now, E naught, it is given in 4.2 electron volt. So what we have to do, we have to first convert this electron volt into joule. So for conversion, 1 electron volt is equals to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule, right? So we will convert it into joule. So this is the E naught value in joule, 6.72 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Now, energy absorbed by the electron. What is the energy absorbed by the electron? It is E is equals to H mu. So H mu, we know that mu is equals to C by lambda, where C is the speed of the light and lambda is the wavelength. So on using this, we will calculate the kinetic energy, 6.626 into 10 to the power minus 34. This is the value of H, Planck's constant. C is the value of speed of light, and lambda. Lambda is, yeah, it is divide sign in between. Lambda is 2000 into 10 to the power minus 10. Minus 10 because it is given in angstrom. We have to find it in meter. So similarly, the answer comes out to be 9.94 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Okay. So kinetic energy of the photoelectron emitted is 9.94 minus 6.72 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule, which comes out to be 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. So 3.2 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule, option number 3. Option number 3 is the correct option. Okay. Next is question number 59. According to Thomson, the amount of deviation of the particles from their path in the presence of electrical or magnetic field depends upon. So let us see, it depends upon whether it depends upon the magnitude of the negative charge on the particle, the mass of the particle, the strength of the electric or magnetic field, or all of the above. So it depends upon, So Thomson suggested that the amount of deviation of the particles from their path in the presence of electric or magnetic field, it depends upon the magnitude of the negative charge on the particles. Okay, so it depends upon the magnitude of negative charge of the particles. Greater the charge of the particle, greater is the interaction with the electric or magnetic field and greater in the deflection. Mass of the particle, the lighter the particle, the greater the deflection. Strength of the electric or magnetic field. Okay, so it says that amount of deviation of the particles from their path in the presence of electric or magnetic field depends upon. So it depends upon all of the above. Okay, it depends upon all of the above. See, the reason is also given how they are varying with each other. So you can see the explanation. You can see the detailed explanation for this question. Question number 60. Question number 60 says, given below are the two statements. Statement 1 says that 0.0071 has two significant figures. Statement 2 says that zeros preceding to its first non-zero digits are not significant. In the light of the above statements, so this is from significant figures only. So some rules for significant figures are all the non-zero numbers are significant. So these are the rules. Okay. All the non-zero numbers are significant. Zeros located between non-zero digits are significant. And trailing zeros at the end will be significant only if contains a decimal point, otherwise they are insignificant. Zeros to the left of the first non-zero digit are insignificant. So we have to see this point only, that if any non-significant, any significant number, 7-1 is significant only, and if any zeros are added before that to the left of it, then they are insignificant. So as we know the number is less than 1, then all the non-zero digits are always significant, and zeros after the first non-zero is still significant, but zeros before the first non-zero are insignificant. Okay, so 0.0071, so these are only having only two significant digits, that is 7 and 1. So both statement 1 and statement 2 are correct. Okay, so let's see the 61 question number. Consider the following statement about the photoelectric effect. So the photo, consider the following statement about the photoelectric effect. So photoelectric effect, what does it say? The number of electron is ejected in proportional to intensity of light. There is no time lag between the striking of light beam and the ejection of electron from the metal surface. Work function of magnesium is greater than copper. Okay, the correct option are. So we have to find out the correct statement. So let's see. When a photoelectric effect is observed, the number of electrons ejected is proportional to the intensity of incident light. Okay, so number of photoelectrons ejected is proportional to the intensity of light. So this statement is correct. The electrons are ejected from the metal surface as soon as the beam of light strikes to the surface. So there is no time lag. So this statement is also correct. Statement B is also correct. Work function of the magnesium and copper are 3.70 and 4.80, which indicates that third statement is wrong. So it is given that work function of magnesium is greater than. So work function of magnesium is equals to 3.70. Okay, and work function of what is given, copper is 4.80. So in the statement it is written that magnesium is greater, which is clearly a wrong statement. So which is the correct statement among all these? First one, A and B are the correct statement. Okay, next is question number 62. The de Broglie wavelength associated with a particle of mass is given as 100 milligram, moving with a velocity is given as 20 meter per second, and h value is given as 6.6 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second. Okay, so we have to find out the de Broglie wavelength. We have to find out the wavelength in this case. So de Broglie wavelength is associated. So this formula, lambda is equals to mv by h. So we are going with this formula. H is the Planck's constant, m is the mass, and v is the velocity. All of these are given. We have to find out the wavelength. So mass of the particle, it is given in milligram. So first we have to convert it in kg. Okay, now velocity is given, and de Broglie wavelength we have to find out, which is h by and V. Okay. So similarly, H is 6.626 into 10 to the power minus 34, and M is in kg, and V is in 20 meter per second. So 3.3 into 10 to the power minus 31 meter. Okay. So option number 4. Option number 4 is the correct option. 3.3 into 10 to the power minus 31 meter is the correct answer. Next is question number 63. In question number 63, the pair of series of spectral lines for hydrogen atom which falls in infrared region is. Okay. So infrared region, the spectral lines of hydrogen atoms. Pair of spectral lines for hydrogen atom that fall in the infrared region are Paschen and Brackett series. Paschen and Brackett, option number 2. How? Because this series correspond to the transition from higher energy level n is greater than equals to 4 to, which means that n2 is greater than equals to 4 and n1 is equals to 3, to the n equals to 3 and n equals to 2 level, 3 or 2. Okay. So when the electron transition from higher state to lower energy state, the Balmer series appears. Okay. The Balmer series appears. All the wavelength in the Balmer series are visible in the visible region to the electromagnetic spectrum. The presence of hydrogen is detected by using the, okay, so you can read all this. Okay, the Lyman series is a hydrogen spectrum and it results, okay, so option number 2. Paschen. Question number 64. What is the number of photons of light with a wavelength of 4000 picometer that provides 1 joule of energy? Wavelength is given to us 4000 picometer that provides 1 joule of energy. Okay, what is the number of photons of light? So it is asked, question number 64. So energy of photon. Energy of photon is given by h mu, where h is the Planck's constant and mu is the frequency of photon. So energy of a photon is number of n h mu. Okay, so n is equals to E naught. N is equals to E naught lambda by hc. This is the formula. C is the speed of light, lambda is the wavelength, and lambda we know that it is in picometer, so we have to convert it in meter by multiplying it with 10 to the power minus 12 meter. Now substituting this value, n value, E naught is, E naught here is 1, lambda value is 4000 into 10 to the power minus 12, h value and c value we know that, so n is equals to 2.012 into 10 to the power minus 16. Option number 2. 2.012 into 10 to the power minus 16. Okay, it will be minus here. Minus 16. So this is the correct option. So next is question number 65. In question number 65, consider the following statement. Okay. Bohr theory can be applied to species having helium plus lithium plus 2 beryllium plus 3, and energy of the stationary state is associated with these kinds of ions, given as En is equals to 218 into 10 to the power minus 18 z square by n square. Okay, next statement is, in case of absorption spectrum Ni is greater than Nf, and in case of emission spectrum Nf is greater than Ni. De Broglie suggested that matter, like matter, radiation should also exhibit dual behavior. Okay, double T it should be. Heisenberg's uncertainty principle rules out existence of definite path or trajectories of electron. So let us see which is the correct statement. Okay, choose the incorrect statement. Yeah, we have to find out which is the incorrect statement. So statement 2 is incorrect. How statement 2 is incorrect? Let us see. Statement 2 says that in case of absorption spectra, okay, it is talking about absorption and emission spectra. So in case of absorption spectra, in case of absorption spectra, NF is greater than NI, okay, but in the case of absorption spectra, it is given NI is greater than NF, so it should be opposite. And in case of emission spectra, emission spectra, Ni should be greater than Nf, but it is given that Nf should be greater than Ni, so it is also incorrect. So option number 2 is the incorrect statement, which means option 4 or only 2. it is the incorrect statement there, right? So it is not applicable to multi electron system like lithium, which has two electrons in the Bohr theory, could not explain the splitting of lines. So you can see the detailed explanation for the rest of the statements. Next is question number 66. Which of the following statement is or are incorrect regarding photoelectric effect? Okay, so photoelectric effect, the number of electrons ejected is proportional to the intensity of light. Okay, so number of electrons ejected is proportional to the intensity of incident light. Okay, so which of the following is incorrect? We have to find out the incorrect. This is the correct statement. Next is, there is some time lag between the striking of light beam on the metal surface and the ejection of electron. So this is the incorrect statement, because as soon as the light beam is falls on the metal surface, now the electrons are emitted then and there. So there is no time lag between them. Okay, so there is no time lag. So this is the incorrect statement. Next is, the kinetic energy of the ejected electrons depends upon the brightness of the light. So kinetic energy is increases linearly with the frequencies, but it is independent of the intensity of light, intensity of radiation. So option 3 is also incorrect. Okay, so this is option 4 is the correct option. Option for question number 66, option 2, which is second and third, these are the incorrect statement. Okay, now question number 67. Question number 67 says, the third line of Balmer series in the emission spectrum of the hydrogen atom is due to the transition from. The third line is due to the transition from. Okay. So let us see. The spectral lines of the Balmer series will be observed when the transition of electron will take place from higher energy state to second Bohr orbit. So first line 3 to 2, second line 4 to 2, and the third line is 5 to 2. So if it is 5 to 2, then it is 5th Bohr to the 2nd Bohr. Okay, right, 5th Bohr to the 2nd Bohr. So it is the third line of Balmer series due to the 5th Bohr to 2nd Bohr orbit. So option number 2 will be the correct option. Question number 68. The frequency of a radiation emitted when the electron falls from n is equals to 4 to n is equals to 1 in a hydrogen atom will be given by. So given ionization is given. Ionization energy is given to us, which is 2.18 into 10 to the power minus 18 joule per atom. H is also given to us. So we have to find out the frequency. So frequency of the radiation can be calculated when the electrons can be fall from n is equals to 4 to n is equals to 1. Okay, so we know that electrons are emitted from n is equals to 4 to n is equals to 1. It is given in the question. So we can use the Rydberg formula. Delta is equals to EF minus EI. Okay, EF is the E final and EI is the E initial, is equals to minus 2.18 into 10 to the power minus 18 NF square minus 2.18 into 10 to the power minus 18 NI square. Okay, so here delta E is the change in energy, EF is the energy of the final state, which means Ni is equals to 1, and Ei is the initial state. Initial is N is equals to 4. Okay, it is final, it is initial. Now, NF is the principal quantum number of the final state, and Ni is the principal quantum number of the initial state. So 2.12 ionization energy is given to us. This is ionization energy. So substituting this value, this we can find out. So delta E, if we are using I is equals to here and I, okay, this is the first formula. This is the first formula. Then EF and EI are expanded to this. Okay, so similarly, by putting all these values, we find out that delta is equals to minus 2.4375 into 10 to the power minus 18. So which is the correct answer here? Option number 3. Okay. Some more is left. Now we know that the change in energy is related to energy of photon. So emitted photon is equals to delta E is equals to HF. Okay, so F is equals to delta E by H. So here see, the frequency, or you can write mu also. So delta E, what we have find out, 2.435 into 10 to the power minus 18, and what is H? H is given, which is 6.625 into 10 to the power minus 36. So here frequency we can calculate at 3.08 into 10 to the power minus 15. Okay, or second inverse, or we can also say it is hertz. So negative sign indicates that energy is being emitted. So okay. So this is the final answer. Next is question number 69. So in question number 69, a bromine atom has 35 protons. How many neutrons and electrons does the most common isotope of bromine contain? Okay, so let us see. Okay, so bromine has 35 protons. Okay, so number of protons in bromine is given as 35. So proton, which means that its atomic number is also 35 of bromine, right? Now number of mass number. Okay, so mass number is equals to 81. It is given that it is the isotope of bromine, so mass number is 81. So now number of proton is given, mass number is also given. Next is number of neutrons. So number of neutrons is what is number of neutrons? It is mass number minus atomic number, right? Mass number minus atomic number. Mass number here we have 81 and atomic number here we have 35, which is equals to 46. Next is number of electrons. How many number of electrons are there? So number of electrons is equal to the number of protons for a neutral atom. So for a neutral atom, bromine is a neutral atom, number of protons are 35, so number of electrons is also 35. Okay, so which is the correct answer? Option number 3 is the correct answer for this question. Okay, 69, answer 3. So 69, option number 3 is the correct option. Okay, next is question 70. In question 70, a local radio station broadcast at 650 kilohertz. What is the wavelength of the radio wave emitted by the station, given that the speed of light is itna? Okay, so the local radio station broadcast at 650 hertz. So speed of light, one second. Yeah. So speed of light, we know that it is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. Frequency is 650 kilohertz. Okay, now convert frequency to hertz. 1 kilohertz equals to 1000 hertz. Therefore 650 hertz. Okay, this frequency is kilohertz. So kilohertz, we have to convert it in hertz. So 650 kilohertz into 1000, which is 650,000 hertz. Okay. Now we have to apply the formula, which is lambda is equals to speed of light into frequency. Lambda is equals to c by mu. So lambda is equals to speed of light is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second, and mu is equals to 65000. This much. Now calculate the wavelength. So wavelength here comes out to be 461.5 meter. Okay, so option one is the correct answer to this question. Next is question number 71. In question number 71, the correct order of dipole moment for molecules NS3, H2S, CH4 and HF. Correct order of dipole moment is given. Okay, so dipole moment of the molecule is defined as the product of magnitude of charge on the either end of both of the bond and the distance between the charges. Okay, so dipole moment is the product of magnitude of charge and the distance between the charges. So let us see, symmetrical and linear geometries have zero dipole moment. So we know that those molecules which have symmetrical and linear geometry, they have zero dipole moment because of the dipole of the separate bonds cancel out. Now CH4 is a tetrahedral molecule, right? CH4 is a tetrahedral molecule. This type of shape is there of CH4, and this results in the each bond is at equal distance, so they are symmetrically placed, so each dipole moment is balanced and the net dipole moment is zero for CH4 because all are symmetrical. Now dipole moment of HF, HF is a polar molecule, so it is highly polar because fluorine is more electronegative, so dipole moment is HF dipole moment is 1.91. now for H2S, the H2S is also a polar molecule and its dipole moment is 0.97, and water is also a polar molecule, so its dipole moment is 1.85. so we have to arrange accordingly. So CH4 will have zero dipole moment, then HF will have 1.91, then H2S will have 0.97 and H2O will have 1.85. so most highest will be HF, okay, HF, then H2O, okay. Okay, here it is given NH3. Okay, so CH4 is not given, NH3 is given. So NH3 will have, okay, sorry, H2O is not given. H2O is not given in the question. Okay, so NH3 will have a dipole moment which is between HF and H2S. Okay, it is between HF and H2S. So it will be something around 1.5 something. Okay. So H2O is not there. So HF, then NH3, then next is H2S, and then is CH4. Okay. So which is the correct answer here? Option number 4. Option 4 is the correct answer for this question. Question number 71. Now, next is question number 72. Next is question number 72. Which of the following sets of molecules will have zero dipole moment? Okay. So this question, for this question, we have to find out the dipole moment. So option 3 is the correct option for this question. Now for the other options, you can draw and check the dipole moment. So I am drawing for the correct one only. Boron trifluoride. Okay. The figure given. Yeah, the figure is given. So boron trifluoride, it will be having this type of structure. Its dipole moment is zero. Okay. Next is beryllium difluoride. Beryllium difluoride will have this type of linear structure and the dipole moment is also zero. Then carbon dioxide, its dipole moment is also zero. And then 1,4-dichlorobenzene, this dipole moment is also zero. Okay, so for this type of we can draw the dipole moment, we can draw the structure first and find out the dipole moment. So option number 3 for 72. Next is 73. For question number 73, match the species in column 1 with the type of hybrid orbitals in column 2 and choose the correct option from the codes given below. Okay, so for this hybridization, we know that what is hybridization. So now let us find its hybridization of this molecule. Okay, so we can find out the hybridization, total number of hybrid orbitals we can find out by simple formula, which is number of sigma bond made by the central atom plus number of lone pair on the central atom. Okay, so let us see. SF4 have 4 sigma bond and 1 lone pair. Okay, SF4 is like this. SF4, for this question, this type of question, you have to know the structure of the compound, so then only you can use this formula. So 4 sigma bonds are there and 1 lone pair is there, so therefore bond pair of the hybrid orbitals, it is 4 and lone pair is 1, so total hybridization is 5. So for 5, total hybridization is sp3b. okay, this is the total hybridization. Okay, so these are not arranged properly. 8 time So total hybridization is like this, and load pair is like this, bond pair is like this. Okay, clear. Now next is IF5. So for IF5, the number of bond pair is IF5 is like this. Okay, IF5, and here it is one lone pair. So five bond pairs are there, and one lone pair is there. And total hybridization, it becomes sp3d2 it becomes. Okay, so option a, sf4 will have sp3d, which means a will have option 3. Next b will have sp3d2, b will have option 1. Okay, c no2 will have two bond pair. Okay, NO2 like this, and here it is positive charge. So like this, two bond pair are there, and two sigma bonds are there, and lone pair, it does not have any lone pair. So its hybridization will be sp. Okay, it is a linear shape. So NO2 will have sp hybridization. So c will have option 2, and b NH4 will be similar to that of CH4. Okay, and here it is positive charge. So it will have four sigma bond and zero lone pair. So its hybridization will be sp3. So d will have option 4 as the correct option. Okay, so which is the correct option here? Option number 2. Option 2 is the correct option for this question. Okay, next is 74 question. Question 74. Assertion says that lone pair repulsion is greater than lone pair bond pair and bond pair interaction. Okay, and the reason is the space occupied by lone pair electron is more as compared to bond pair electrons. So lone pair is localized to a single atom. Since the lone pair are localized to an atom, they are close to each other, and hence they have more repulsion between them. The bond pair are delocalized between atoms, and hence they are relatively far away and always have less repulsion as compared to lone pair, because the electrons in the lone pair are not involved in the bonding, and thus the repulsion is higher. So because of free electrons, the repulsion between a lone pair and bond pair is somewhat higher than that of bond pair and lone pair. It is because the orbitals that house the lone pair are distinct from. Okay, so you don't have to read this much of explanation. So it means that the assertion is correct and the reason is correct. It just justifies that the lone pair repulsion is greater than the lone pair bond pair and bond pair repulsion. Okay, so repulsion we are talking about, and why it is so? It is because the space occupied by lone pair electrons is more as compared to bond pair electrons. So yeah, option number 1 is the correct option. So assertion and reason are correct for this question. Question number 75. In question number 75, which of the following statement is not correct? Okay, so double bond is shorter than the single bond is weaker than the pi bond, double bond is stronger than a single bond, and covalent bond is stronger than the hydrogen bond. As the extent of overlap of atomic orbitals forming the sigma bond is more as compared to extent of overlapping orbitals formed by a pi bond. Okay, you can just read all the questions. Option number 2, sigma bond is weaker than the pi bond. So this statement is not correct. Okay, because sigma bond is stronger than the pi bond. Sigma bond is the first bond that is formed between the molecules. So it is the stronger one. Okay. Question number 76. When O2 is converted to O2 plus, what will happen? Okay, so its bond order. When O2 is converted to O2 plus, its bond order is 2. O2 has 2 unpaired electrons, and in O2 plus 2, it has 0 unpaired electrons. So when O2 is converted to O2 plus, the paramagnetic character decreases and the bond order increases. So option number 4, paramagnetic character decreases and the bond pair order increases. Okay, so this is the correct answer. Question number 77. In question number 77, which of the following has the maximum bond order? So we can find out the bond order for all the oxygen molecules. Bond order, we know that bond order equals to number of bonding electrons minus number of antibonding electrons by 2. Okay, number of bonding electrons minus number of antibonding electrons by 2. Now, so bond order of O2 minus is 1.5, bond order of O2 plus is 2.5, bond order of O2, 2 minus is 1 and bond order of O2 is 2. So which is the correct option? Which is the lowest? Okay, maximum bond order is asked. Maximum is for O2 plus. O2 plus is option 2. Okay, for 77, option 2 is the correct option. Next is question 78. Match the species given in column 1 with the shape given in column 2 and the correct option. Okay, so for question 78, this is the table in column A. We have to match the shape of the orbitals. Now, XCF4 has a square planar shape. Okay, so this is the structure. XCF4 has a square planar shape. So A will have option 3. A will have option 3, which means 1 is cut and 2 is cut. Okay, next is I3 minus will have a bent shape. Okay, I3 minus will have a bent shape. Will have a bent shape. So B option will have option 4. B will have option 4 as the correct option, which means option 3 is the correct option in this case. Okay, similarly NO2 plus, it will have linear shape. NO2 plus will have linear shape, which means D will have first, and PCl3 will have pyramidal shape. Okay, so option number 3 is the correct option. Next is question number 79. Question number 79 says, in the molecule SO2 sulfur dioxide, the central sulfur atom forms double bond with the two oxygen atoms. What type of hybridization does the sulfur atom undergo? Okay, so in SO2 we have to find out the hybridization of the central sulfur atom. Okay, it's not given. So sulfur is in the ground state, which have first shell full. So for SO2 na, SO2 you can see SO2 will have this type of structure. Sulfur dioxide, central sulfur atom forms a double bond with the two oxygen atom. What type of hybridization does the sulfur atom undergo? So this is only the sulfur atom, and it will undergo sp2 hybridization. It will not be linear. Okay, it will not be linear, but it will be sp2 hybridized. Hybridization of the two oxygen atoms. Okay, what type of hybridization does the sulfur atom undergo? Hybridization of a principal sulfur atom in this compound is sp2. Hybridization of the two oxygen atom is sp2. Yeah, so why it is so? Because it has one lone pair of electrons. Okay, so because of one lone pair of electrons, its hybridization, its actual its expected hybridization should be sp, because it is a linear shape molecule now, but it is sp2. Okay, it is sp2 because of one lone pair of electrons. Fine. Next is question number 80. Carbon dioxide exists as linear molecule. What type of hybridization does the central atom undergo in CO2? Carbon dioxide exists as a linear molecule. So carbon dioxide is similar as SO2, but it will not have any lone pair of electrons. Okay, so the linear atom exists as a linear. What type of hybridization does the central carbon atom undergo? Okay, so carbon atom will undergo sp2 hybridization only. So carbon atom will undergo sp hybridization only. Okay, central atom will undergo is sp hybridized. It has two double bonds, each involving sp2 hybridization. So oxygen, which is attached to carbon, these are experiencing sp2 hybridized, but the central atom is sp hybridized. Okay, so option number 1 is correct. Next is question number 81. Deviation of oxygen-oxygen bond length in ozone molecule from the normal bond length seems... Okay, so what is in this question? Deviation of oxygen-oxygen bond length in ozone molecule forms normal bond length seems as single bond length decreases while double bond length increases from the normal. This is because of resonance. Okay, so what happens in oxygen? A resonance is there. So because of this, the bond length of... double bond increases. Okay, bond length of double bond increases, so single bond length decreases while double bond length increases because of resonance in ozone. So next is question number 82. Match question match list 1 with list 2. Okay. So again this type of structure 1 is given. We can find out the structure by this formula also. Half is equals to number of valence electrons by number of monovalent atom minus charge on cation plus charge on anion. Okay. So these are neutral species, so charge of anion and charge of cation is not required. Or we can find out by the previous formula also, which is bond pair and lone pair one, number of bond pair plus number of lone pairs. So let's see. For NH3, it has 5 valence electrons, and NH3 out of 5 electrons are involved in bonding. So it will have the pyramidal shape. So NH3 will have the pyramidal shape, right? NH3 will have the pyramidal shape. So trigonal pyramidal. Okay, it will have trigonal pyramidal. So A will have option 1. Option 1, which means option 3 is the only the correct answer. Right. So also let us see BRF5. For BRF5 will have 1 lone pair. So BRF5 will have square planar, square pyramidal geometry. Next is SF6. SF6 will have octahedral geometry. SF6 will have octahedral. So D will have option 3, and C will have, HCF4 will have square planar geometry. Okay. Option 3 is the correct option. Next is question number 83. Question number 83, which of the following is not correct order of dipole moment? Okay, so dipole moment order, see, dipole moment order is given for this compound. So the order of dipole moment will be this. It is asked that which is not the correct order. So option 3 is not the correct order. Okay, you can find for the others also. Option 3 is not the correct order of dipole moment, because see, CH3Cl, it will have a bond order of, wait a second, I am zooming the image. Okay, so it will have a bond order of 1.60. Then it is CH2Cl2 will have bond order of 1.60. Then CHCl3 will have a bond order of 1.08, and CH3Cl, it will have zero dipole moment. So according to this, the correct dipole moment will be, which one is greater, CHCl3, it will have greater than CH2Cl2 and then CCl4. Okay, but here it is given CHCl3, then CH2Cl2, then CH3Cl. Okay, so this is the incorrect option. This is the incorrect option. CH3Cl, it will have the least, it will have the least dipole moment. So therefore option number 3 will have the incorrect dipole moment and the correct option to this question. Question number 84 says that which of the following represents all isoelectronic species? Okay, Na plus, so isoelectronic species, see, option number 4 is the correct option. So how Na plus isoelectronic species? Okay, first we have to find out that what is isoelectronic species. So these are the species which have the same number of electrons. Okay, so these are the same number of electrons. So let us see all the options. We can see Na will have 10 electrons. Then Cl minus will have 18, O minus will have 17, NO plus will have 14, N2O will have 22, N2O4 will have 46, NO plus will have 14. So like all this, now calcium plus 2, it will have 18 electrons, Ar will have 18, potassium will have 18, and Cl plus will have 18. So option 4, these all are isoelectronic species. Okay. Question 85, amongst the following, which one will have the maximum lone pair electron repulsion? So lone pair electron repulsion, which will have the highest? Xcf4 will have the highest electronic repulsion. Okay, because two fluorine atoms are there and they both are like opposite to each other. Okay, and three lone pairs are also there. Xcf2, okay, like this, the structure is like this. Here one lone pair, here one lone pair, and here one lone pair. So option 4, it will have the most loan pair question, because it will have three loan pair. Okay, others does not have this much loan pair. Like the number of loan pair increases, the loan pair interaction increases. Okay. Question number 86. How many sp hybridized carbon atoms and pi bonds are present in the following compound? So this is the compound we have to find out, that how many sp hybridized carbon atoms are present, sp 2 hybridized carbon atom and pi bonds we have to find. Okay, so sp hybridized, there are in number of carbon atoms in benzene are 6, number of carbon atom in 6 which are sp 2 hybridized. Okay, all are sp 2 hybridized only, because in benzene, this is the structure of benzene. Okay, so like this, so this carbon will have how much sigma bond are there? 1 sigma bond, 2 sigma bond and 3 sigma bond. Okay, so 3 sigma bond, which means it will have sp2 hybridization. Okay, in organic compounds na, how it is done, that if 2 sigma bonds are there, then it is sp hybridized. If 3 sigma bonds are there, then it is sp2 hybridized. Then if 4 sigma bonds are there, it is sp3 hybridized. So this is the trick for organic compounds. You can learn how to write the hybridization of organic compounds. Okay, like the ones containing carbon. So it is clear. So see, this carbon is also having 3 sigma bonds, so it is sp2. This carbon is also having 3 sigma bonds. Okay, one H is there to each carbon, so all are having 3 sigma bonds. So similarly, how much sigma bonds are there, how much sp hybridized carbon are there? There are 6 in the benzene ring and they are forming 1 sigma bond and 1 double bond with the same adjacent carbon. Okay, so option number 2. And here also 1 sp2 carbon, this carbon C double bond O, this carbon is also sp2 hybridized. Okay, so this one is there. Now 7 sp2 hybridized carbon are there, and how much pi bond are there? Pi bond is also asked. Now the 6 pi bond, 1 2 3 4 5 and 6, here triple bond, carbon triple bond carbon, so triple bond means there are 2 pi bonds that are there. Okay, so 6 pi bond, which means option 2 is the correct option. Next is question number 87. So in question number 87, which one of the following statement is incorrect related to molecular orbital theory? So option number 3 is incorrect, because molecular orbital obtained from 2px and 2py are symmetrical around the bond axis. So it is not such. Okay, so molecular orbitals obtained from 2px and 2py are unsymmetrical. So they are unsymmetrical, so this is the incorrect statement. Question number 88. The correct order of energies of molecular orbital of N2 molecule. Okay, question number 88. So option 4 is the correct option for question number 88. So this is the correct arrangement, you can check from here. Okay, in question number 89, which amongst the following is an incorrect statement? Okay, so in question number 89, the bond order can be calculated. Okay, so it is related to bond order. We can calculate it by using this formula. Number of bonding electron minus number of antibonding electron minus 2. Okay, so option number 4, O2 plus ions are diamagnetic. Okay, so O2 plus ions are diamagnetic. It is having 2.5 molecular. Okay, so all the bond orders are like this. So this is the correct statement. All the bond order are given here. First is the correct statement. Next, the incorrect statement is O2 plus ions are diamagnetic. So the total number of electrons of O2 plus is 15. Molecular orbital configuration is also given. There is one unpaired electrons in the pi antibonding orbital. So if there is one electron here, so if it is one unpaired electron, so it should be paramagnetic. Okay, it is not diamagnetic. So option 4 is the incorrect statement. Question number 90. A bonding molecular orbital always possesses lower energy than either of the atomic orbitals that have overlapped to form it. Okay, because, so what is the reason? Electron placed in the bonding molecular orbitals tend to hold the nuclei together and stable the molecule. Okay, option number 1 is only the correct option. You can read the explanation for more details. क्वेश्चन नंबर 91 assertion reason BRF5 and SF6 have same hybridization. Okay, so BRF5 have hybridization. Its hybridization is sp3d2. And what is next? SF6. SF6 is also having sp3d2. So these both have same hybridization and its geometry. BRF5 has square pyramidal geometry. Okay, BRF5 has square pyramidal geometry. It is 2, and SF6 has octahedral geometry. So this is also 2. So option number 91. Question number 91, option number 2 is the correct option. Okay, both assertion and reason are true, but reason is not the correct explanation. Okay, why these both have the same hybridization? This reason is not the correct, because it is only given the shape. Okay, so it is not the correct explanation, although these both are individually correct statement. Question number 92. Next is question number 92. In question number 92, H2O molecule has V-shaped and two lone pair of electrons. Okay, H2O molecule is V-shaped with two lone pair of electrons. SF4 has seesaw. Correct statement we have to find out. So SF4 have seesaw. Okay. SF4 has seesaw shape with one lone pair of electrons in the central sulfur atom. So this is also true. This is also true. CLF3 is a T-shaped molecule with two lone pair of electrons. So CLF3 has T-shaped molecule with two lone pair of electrons, which is due to the lone pairs occupying the equatorial position of the central chlorine atom. So this statement is also true, which means all of the above, all are correct. In question number 93, match the following. Okay, so see, trigonal pyramidal geometry is given. So what is the, if one lone pair is given, this is the expected geometry that are given to us. Okay, but what is the actual geometry we have to find out. So if a trigonal pyramidal molecule is there like this type, so it will have seesaw shape. So option A will have option 4. Option 2 is the correct option. Next is trigonal bipyramidal is the expected shape for this type of compound. It will have T-shaped as the correct answer. So option 2. And octahedral will have square pyramidal. So option 3. And octahedral will have square planar. So option 1. So option 2 is the correct answer. Okay. Question number 94. Which of the following is correct representation of resonance? Option A and B is given. Which is the correct option? Both form of resonance is correct. So, okay, so CO2 resonance is also correct, and CO3 minus. So these both are correct. So option 3, both A and B are correct resonance structures. When a sodium metal reacts with water, it forms hydrogen gas and sodium hydroxide. Which type of bonding is present in sodium hydroxide? So sodium hydroxide, which type of bonding? If sodium metal is react with water, it forms hydrogen gas and sodium hydroxide. So in sodium hydroxide, ionic bonding is only present, right? Ionic bonding is present in sodium hydroxide, because sodium is a metal and oxygen and hydrogen is a non-metal. So the bonding formed between metal and non-metal is ionic bonding. Question number 96. In the SF4 molecules, the central sulfur atoms form a single bond with 4 fluorine atoms. Okay, this is the SF4 molecule. What is the most likely shape of the molecule? So here one lone pair is also there. So if one lone pair is there, so it will form a seesaw structure. Okay, it will form a seesaw structure and not a tetrahedral structure. So you can read the whole explanation part for this. Question number 97. The electronegativity difference between two bonded atoms determine the type of covalent bond form. A large difference suggests an ionic bond, while a small difference suggests a non-polar bond. What type of bond will exist between carbon and hydrogen? Okay. If CH4 molecule is there, then what type of bonding will exist between carbon and hydrogen molecule? A non-polar covalent bond is exist. Okay, because carbon has electronegativity of 2.5 and hydrogen is having of 2.1. So there is a difference of 0.4. Okay, so there is a table in which, you can find out that which bond is of which type. Like non-polar covalent, the difference in the electronegativity is 0.5. If the difference in the electronegativity is 2, then it will be polar covalent. And if it is greater than 2, then it will be ionic difference. So if we are getting 0.5, then which is less than 0.5, it is a non-polar covalent. Okay. Question number 98. The Lewis structure of sulfuric acid shows 2SO bond, double bonds and 2OH single bonds. What is the sulfuric acid? H2SO4. Okay. H2SO4, it shows 2S double bond O. Okay, it is showing 2 double bond O and 2 OH bond. Okay, like this. So what is the formal charge of the sulfur atom? So for formal charge, we can use this formula. V is the valence electron, N is the non-bonding valence electron, and B is the bonding electron. Okay, number of electrons in the bonds. So here we can calculate, S is the central atom, it will form 2 double bonds with the 2 hydrogen atom. Okay, and thus the formal charge on sulfur is valence electron of sulfur minus number of electrons minus number of bonds. Hence the formal charge is 0. So formal charge is 0 for this type of H2SO4 molecule. Question number 99 says the bond length is the distance between the nuclei of 2 bonded atom. Which of the following result is shorter bond? So here higher electronegativity difference between the atoms. Okay. Okay, so option 2 is the correct option here. Okay, option 2 is the correct option. Question number 99, option number 2. More electrons involved in the bonding. More electrons involved in the bonding. Option 2 is the correct option. When more electrons are involved in the bonding, such double bonds or triple bonds compared to single bonds, the strength increases and the bond length decreases. This is because the increased electron density between the nucleus resulting in the shorter bond. So bond length distance between the two bond length is okay. Which of the following factors will result in the shorter bond? So more electrons will involved in the bonding. Question number 100. Hybridization involves the mixing of atomic orbital to form new atomic orbital with different shapes of energies. How many sp2 hybridized orbitals are formed when a carbon atom undergoes sp2 hybridization? So how many sp2 hybridized orbitals are formed? So 3 are formed. When a carbon atom undergoes sp2 hybridization, it mixes 3 of its atomic orbital. Okay, 1 2s and 2 2p. So 3 atomic orbitals are mixed. Option number 3 is correct. 3 atomic orbitals are mixed. Okay, so which 3 are mixed, I have told you, and you can see in the description and you can see in the detail explanation then how 3 are mixed. Okay, so this is for chemistry. So keep learning, students. If you find any mistakes or it is difficult to understand any solution, so you can text in the BTS support group, or you can directly comment on the YouTube channel. Okay, YouTube video. We are very happy to help you in that. Okay, thank you so much, students.